New details emerge on the health condition of U.S. Defense Secretary Lloyd Austin. In a statement, the Walter Reed National Military Medical Center said Austin is being treated for prostate cancer and he suffered complications that led to his hospitalization on New Year's Day. The cancer was discovered in early December. The hospital said Austin is recovering. The Pentagon has faced backlash over the secrecy on Austin's hospitalization, with even U.S. President Joe Biden kept in the dark.
This review will help us understand where we can do better in terms of making sure that part of the notification timeline, not only to include the chain of command, but also the public notification timeline, is taken into account. In terms of how we, the timeline and how we get to where we're at the point of, okay, it's time to let the public know, you know, clearly we could have done better and we will do better.
A U.S. appeals court questions former President Donald Trump's claims that he is immune from criminal charges for trying to overturn the 2020 election. Trump's lawyers claimed his time in office protects him from charges, but the Justice Department argued the presidency was not above the law. As for Trump, he insists he did nothing wrong. He also threatened to go after U.S. President Joe Biden if he returns to the White House.
You can't have a president without immunity. You have to have, as a president, you have to be able to do your job. But if this didn't work out, if I wasn't given immunity, then other presidents, when we talked about today, President Obama with the drone strikes, which were very bad, they were mistakes, terrible mistakes. You really can't put a president in that position.
Trump is due to go on trial in March on federal charges of election subversion. French President Emmanuel Macron names 34-year-old Education Minister Gabriel Attal as the country's new prime minister. This makes Attal France's youngest and first openly gay prime minister. His appointment won't lead to any major political shift, but it signals a desire by Macron to move beyond last year's unpopular pension and immigration reforms ahead of the European Parliament elections. Attal has polled as one of France's most popular politicians in recent months. He also became a household name in French politics as the government's spokesman during the COVID-19 pandemic. Now, chaos erupts in Ecuador after President Daniel Noboa declares a 60-day state of emergency. This is in response to the disappearance of notorious gang leader Adolfo Macias from the prison where he was serving a 34-year sentence. Since the declaration, at least 4 police officers have been kidnapped by criminals. Explosions have also occurred in several cities, but tensions reached tipping point after armed men interrupted a live television broadcast. The assailants were seen forcing the staff of TC Television onto the floor as shots and yelling were heard in the background. Ecuador's police later said the armed men have been arrested. Ecuador has declared an internal armed conflict in the country following the violent incidents. U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken says Washington believes the daily toll of the war on civilians in Gaza is far too high. Blinken says Palestinians must be allowed to return home as soon as conditions allow. He adds Arab leaders are ready to invest in the future of Gaza, but only if there's a clear pathway to a Palestinian state.
We know that facing an enemy that embeds itself among civilians, who hides in and fires from schools, from hospitals, makes this incredibly challenging. But the daily toll on civilians in Gaza, particularly on children, is far too high. We want this war to end as soon as possible. There's been far too much loss of life, far too much suffering. But it's vital that Israel achieve its very legitimate objectives of ensuring that October 7th can never happen again.
Blinken also weighed in on South Africa's genocide charge against Israel, calling it meritless.
We believe the submission against Israel to the International Court of Justice distracts the world from all of these important efforts. And moreover, the charge of genocide is meritless. It's particularly galling, given that those who are attacking Israel, Hamas, Hezbollah, the Houthis, as well as their supporter Iran, continue to openly call for the annihilation of Israel and the mass murder of Jews.
Palestine's ambassador to the UN stressing the Arab group's continued effort to seek for a ceasefire between Israel and the Hamas militants. International concern has mounted over the huge Palestinian death toll from the Israeli assault on the enclave. Israel's air and ground offensive, prompted by a cross-border Hamas rampage on October 7, has now killed over 23,000 Palestinians. It also destroyed large areas from northern to southern Gaza.
We will continue to knock on the door of the General Assembly, the Security Council, the Secretary General, Madam Kaag Sigrid, and every component of the United Nations to accomplish the ceasefire. We always welcome any possibility of any outcome that gets us closer to the ceasefire. This is our compass. Everything we do, it has to lead us in the direction of a ceasefire.
The International Criminal Court investigates the deaths of journalists covering the war in Gaza. Media advocacy group Reporters Without Borders filed a complaint with the ICC last year, alleging war crimes over the deaths of the journalists. Based on the record of the Committee to Protect Journalists, at least 79 media professionals have been killed since the war erupted on October 7. The latest addition was Sunday's killing of two Palestinian journalists hit by an Israeli airstrike.